number of people bought huge acreages in the United States and had reports which indicated very, very high potential. None of this is being realized. Many of the acreages have been bought at high cost, but you find that the potential is much less. The cost of production of shale of gas is so low, it's only $2 per MMBTU, which is, you know, it doesn't yield much profit to you. You don't have this, you know, look at the case of oil. In the case of oil, in Saudi Arabia, it costs between $2 to $5 to produce one barrel. You sell it for $100. Here, how much can you make if you are just producing it? You're selling it at $2 per million BTU. So, the price is very low. There are grave uncertainties in regard to ecological damage. Also, the economy is sluggish. Therefore, the demand that you had wanted is not manifesting itself. At the same time, there are political implications. Because the gas is so cheap, suddenly people are excited. And earlier, when you were importing gas, you were paying between $15 to $17 per million BTU. Today, you're getting domestic gas for $2 million. In an election period, the American government has put severe restrictions on the export of this domestic gas. There is only one line that is permitted to be exported from Sabine, but all the other, there are restrictions. Things will change as we go along. These low prices will not be sustainable. They are not sustainable, and in due course, there will be a balancing out. But more resources will be available, but there will be a balancing out. Possibly conventional gas from Qatar and other sources will become cheaper, and this will become more expensive. At some stage, you may find that they come together at, say, $10 per million BTU. But because of the fact that this is frontier technology, many countries in the world have already put restrictions on fracking. The process of hitting the gas, hitting the shale with water and chemicals is called fracking. Hydraulic fracturing is shortened to fracking. So fracking is the thing that is still a very, it is still a controversial thing. Any discussion about energy has to take into account and show sensitivity to climate issues, climate change issues. There is a demand that global emissions come down. More or less, we are on the right track. If you continue using shale gas, if you use shale gas, then you are likely, there's going to be, in any case, there is going to be a significant increase in the consumption of gas vis-a-vis coal. And at some stage, I think shale may even overtake coal in the global energy mix. But you will see that gas has certain emissions in terms of carbon dioxide and carbon monoxide is much less than other competing sources like oil and coal. Therefore, gas is likely to be a cleaner fuel. It will be a cleaner fuel and will make a significant contribution to the control of of carbon emissions. Having said this, we have already noted that there are concerns about fracking. If there are concerns about fracking, which will have a negative impact on other aspects of the ecology, but then again I have pointed out that fracking has produced 600,000 jobs in the United States in just the last few years at a time when the economy is in a very poor condition. Nuclear scenario, again I will not dilate on this too much. Fukushima has changed the scenario quite a bit. There was an earlier a sense of renaissance, a lot of reactors were being commissioned, were being pursued in different parts of the world, including the United States for the first time in 35 years. But Fukushima has made us concerned. Fukushima reminded us that nuclear energy is not the magic wand for energy security, that you have to be cautious about it. It is the only energy source in the world that can do unexpected and extremely extensive damage to you. It can do severe harm to you. The sun can burn you and all the other things, but the point is nuclear energy emits radiation, which is not fully understood and is certainly completely irreversible. Having said so, therefore, Japan itself, which was a world leader in use of nuclear energy for power generation, is today shifting away from nuclear energy and going back in favor of hydrocarbons. So Japan is going to be now a very major importer of gas as against a user of nuclear energy. Now the Arab Spring. Wherever there were reverberations in the Arab world, because of sensitivities relating to oil, there were concerns about supply, prices, and investment. So let us look at each of these issues very quickly. One is Iran. I have already told you that Iran, the large sections of, you have a United States, Israel, and GCC combined against Iran, and therefore from the United States and European Union, there have been severe sanctions, particularly which have affected the Iranian supplies and also investments in the Iranian energy technology. And therefore you find that this has had an immediate impact in terms of supplies. This is the first time in energy history where the consumer is being adversely affected by denying himself access to global energy. Up to now, it was the producer who was putting restrictions and saying, I'm not going to supply to you or I'm going to raise prices. But the first time, a consumer is doing that, and that is Europe. At a time when the European economy is itself in such a poor condition, they have decided to go along with the Americans and deny themselves the energy that they need, and which they have been getting from the Iranians to the extent of 21% of their energy imports, of their oil imports. So this has had, of course, the Saudis, this is entirely political in character. The Saudis have said that, oh, but we can make up for this. If we can make up for this, we have enough surplus. But there are doubts about Saudi surplus. So Saudi Arabia has not had a major discovery for several years. Its last major discovery was 20 years ago at Sheba. Therefore, there are concerns about the Saudi ability to actually generate the surpluses that the international community is now denying itself from Iran. The Americans have said that we will release some oil from our strategic reserve, strategic petroleum reserve, in order to bring prices down. We will see what happens in that regard. Having said all this, the Asian demand for oil continues to grow. Therefore, you cannot deny yourself access to any source. But the Asians are finding it very difficult. The intrusive European and American sanctions are having an adverse impact on our own demand scenario. China, Japan, Republic of Korea, and India are all major consumers of Iranian oil. So this has become an untidy situation. In this untidy situation, we are coming up with creative solutions. Creative solutions which would address the issue of supply, insurance, shipping, how you actually pay, that is the oil trade. For oil trade, we are looking at barter and possible designating it in rupees. We are coming up with ways in which we can insure our ships outside the American and European arrangements. All of these, and these Iranians are offering you discounts. Which country in the world is going to deny itself a discount because oil is so expensive otherwise? They not only provide you a discount, they also give you credit, 3-month credit. If they give you a 3-month credit, you buy Iranian oil, you put it in your refinery, you have the product, you sell the product. After you sold the product and made a huge profit, you then pay for the crude oil. You cannot have anything more wonderful than that. So there are ways in which discounts and barter arrangements are emerging. But when you need something desperately, there is no way someone else is going to say that you should deny yourself this. With regard to choke points, you know, all the principal, the three principal issues that occurred with regard to the Arab Spring were at choke point. First was Egypt. Oh, what's going to happen about the Suez Canal? If there's chaos in the international community, Suez Canal is closed down, and we'll be denied there. When you had agitations in Yemen, it was about Bab al-Mandeb. And now, of course, Iran, there is a discussion about Hormuz. So oil flows are very, very sensitive. They are geopolitically sensitive. And because they're geopolitically sensitive, they have an impact on prices, and they have an impact on the psyche of people. If people become insecure, people become worried about that. So, because India, for example, India gets about 80% of its oil from Qatar, 50% from the GCC, and the balance from Iran and Iraq. How can India afford the closure of the Hormuz? Your supplies is what you like to. Imagine that scenario. Recall that scenario when Iraq occupied Kuwait in 1990. These were the two major sources of oil for us. One was 6 million tons, another 4 million tons. 10 million tons of oil was immediately closed down. It was Saudi Arabia that emerged at that time and made up for all our requirements then. So similarly, there are legitimate concerns in every country with regard to the free flow of oil. My own sense is that I do not envisage a scenario. While I do not say that the fears are baseless and idiotic, there are serious concerns with regard to the scenario relating to Iran. But I personally do not envisage a situation in the near future where Hormuz would actually